Good evening, and welcome to the January meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. I'd like to start our meeting by first reviewing our minutes from the December meeting. If any members of the board have any comments or corrections. If not, a motion.
I move adoption of the minutes as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Motion passes. The next item I'd like to note is we received some correspondence over the past month. Several letters which were distributed to all planning board members. We have in our packets a letter from M. McGovern regarding the Tinsman site plan. We have a memo regarding the status of the tower RFP, which was distributed to the town council as well as the planning board. We also have a request for a planning board representative for the new community center committee. We also have a copy of the 1999 planning board schedule of our meetings for the upcoming year. And before us this evening at the podium is a memo from M. McGovern representing the town of Cape Elizabeth regarding the community swimming pool. Those being noted for the record, we can proceed to old business, the first item of which is the community pool site plan. The town of Cape Elizabeth requesting a site plan review of the community pool expansion project located at the rear of the high school. Under section 19-9, site plan public hearing. And to begin with, it would probably be a good idea, since we covered a lot of ground at our last meeting, to have the applicant come to the podium, identify yourselves, and bring us up to date on what has transpired.
My name is Dave Sear. I live at 15 Macaulay Road. I've been serving as the chair of the pool committee since sometime in mid 1997, and been working with the committee since that time to develop the proposal that that you now have before you and you're considering for approval. Just as a matter of procedure, would you like us as the consultants, Harriman Associates, and then maybe myself as chair to make a few comments before opening the public hearing, or did you wish to proceed into the public hearing first?
I think perhaps just a brief overview without going into all of the details which have been changed at this point in time would be appropriate, and then we'll have the public hearing and follow up on discussion of the state of the design at this point.
Okay, thank you. Just briefly to recap again before Harriman Associates makes their presentation to cover off the items that were identified in the last meeting. What we're talking about here is basically a pool renovation project, and the scope of that project includes completely rebuilding, replacing, and installing a new pool basin, adding stadium or spectator seating, adding a whirlpool facility, completely renovating the lockers, adding a weight room facility, and then changing out all the mechanical systems relating to that pool facility. And the Harriman can refer to the schematic to get into more details on that, but basically that's the scope of the project, and it was a project that was approved by the voters last November for a sum total of $2.2 million, and we're working very diligently to stay on budget in that regard. The like to just briefly state too that we're excited about having reached this stage in the process. It's been a long process. It's involved a lot of work on the part of committee members. Some of the folks are here in the audience this evening. Harriman Associates have done tremendous work for us, and then there has been a lot of work on the part of city staff who have provided valuable support and comments and insight into developing this proposal. The As I mentioned, the citizens voted on this project by 3-1 margin in November. We feel that we have an obligation to them to complete this project on time and on money. And I guess both of those areas will require your support to hopefully approve this plan this evening, if possible, and allowing us to then continue with the next step in the process. I think just as while I'm here, I'd like to just comment briefly that I'm a parent in Cape Elizabeth as well as a taxpayer, and as a parent with two daughters who have been swimming for a number of years, I'm excited about this project because I think it's providing a valuable resource to the community. And I think that not only from my daughter's perspective, but from others as well, I think it was time to make this change. And we're now at the threshold of being able to go down the path that allows us to actually build this facility in hopefully a very short period of time. And we need certainly your support to allow us to continue along that path. Just close by saying again that if we can get your approval tonight, that would be fantastic. And hopefully you'll find everything in order to allow you to do that. Now I'll turn over to Frank Crabtree from Harriman Associates, who will continue the presentation representing Harriman Associates.
I won't get into a lot of detail at this point, but just a brief overview. As we talked last month, the project on the exterior is adding a very small amount actually to the high school building. It's about 5,200 square feet, represented in the orange on these two drawings. This is the, I guess it would be the northwesterly corner, or the southwesterly corner of the of the high school where the pool is now. So there'll be a small expansion in this area here, reworking the entryway so that they'll come in into this new corner. We're only going to be renovating the upper parking lot rather than both parking lots. We're adding about 12 spaces and reorganizing the upper parking lot with handicap spaces, with plantings and new lighting. The lower parking lot we're really doing nothing to other than bringing a new walkway and a new stairway up to the upper level for the entry, right in here. I guess at this point, rather than getting into the questions we had last time, if you'd like to go ahead with the public hearing, and then we'll get into the questions afterwards.
Great, thank you very much. We have a public hearing scheduled for this evening, and therefore at this point in time, I'll open the public hearing, and anyone who wishes to express an opinion or give us some information or background or any reaction to this project, we'd be very anxious to hear anyone's thoughts on the opinion. Merely come to the microphone and identify your residence, and then let us hear what you have to say. With that, I'll open the public hearing.
Hi, my name is Varney Hintley, and I live at 8 Park Circle, and I brought my friend here, Julia, along with me, who's my daughter. And I was a member of that pool committee to which Dave referred, and I can only tell you that the folks who served on this committee spent a lot of time analyzing the various options, both on a qualitative and quantitative basis, to arrive at where we are right now. With the support of the city staff, as well as Harriman Associates, who did, as Dave said, a very, very nice job on this project. As Dave also alluded, we've spent several of the meetings in the last couple of months also analyzing the economics of this project. The budget on this thing, as you might imagine, is very tight. We knew it was tight to begin with when we went to the voters. We've struggled with some items, but I think that we will bring this thing together with the ultimate outcome of having a state-of-the-art pool that will last for hopefully several decades. So naturally, being a competitive swimmer or a master swimmer, an old boy swimmer right now, as well as a strong supporter of schoolboy athletics and the use of this facility not only by children but also by older folks on a therapeutic basis speaks volumes to its advantages to this town. So I can't, I will tell you, I'll close by saying that I'm highly in favor of this. The planning board has a job to protect the public's interest in this town, but I will tell you that I think from a planning and design standpoint, the committee as well as the architectural firm has done its job for this town, and I highly endorse the project. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to come to the microphone? Please do.
Yes, Michael McGovern. I serve as the town manager and ex officio member of the committee. I want to speak for just a moment about parking, and my memo addresses it somewhat. As Frank mentioned, we have changed somewhat the upper parking lot, and I think it's interesting that I often hear when, you know, I speak to developers, when I look at different town applications, we always hear the phrase, the planning board's making us do this or that, and it's costing us money. When I look at this particular parking lot, however, I don't see this as something that the planning board is forcing us to do. In the 20 years that I've worked for the community, we've always had a problem with that upper parking lot, with parking, with traffic circulation. For those of you that have lived in town for a long time, you've seen the guardrails go in, you've seen the guardrails go out, and I think it's you know, been very refreshing to be able to have some professional planning on this parking lot at this time and working with the planner on the issue. And while my memo indicates some of that has thrown us somewhat over budget, I think the committee has really done an exceptional job at looking at other savings in the budget. With that said, you know, I know as we look at the whole school campus, we do hear concerns from the planning board as well as from citizens about parking on the campus. You know, it has been alluded to by others and by myself. This is a real tight budget. And I find that this is probably one of the most difficult projects we've ever had, in that the budget was approved by the citizens very, very early in the process, and with set things that really have an expectation to be done. So as we go down the project, it's really difficult to find funds or to otherwise, you know, find savings in order to get some things done that weren't expected. So I would hope that the planning board, you know, would look at this as a real significant improvement with what is going on, and I really do wish to thank you for your concern about the parking, and also thank Maureen for her assistance working with our Harriman Associates, our consultant, as we've looked at some of the issues in this back area. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to come to the podium? Yes?
Good evening. My name is Joe Kozlowski. I'm also with the committee. Just popped in this evening to give you a few of my words. I was not on the committee as it originally started. I joined late in the game. My background is development and construction, and that's why I was brought on board. As you've heard probably previous to me, that the budget is very tight, and I think we're doing a lot with the dollars for the citizens of the community. As far as the parking lot is concerned, I think some improvements will need to be made to accommodate this project, and I think we've done a good job trying to reflect those improvements and reflect the comments by the planners and this this board. I hope that everybody would look on this project favorably. I think overall it's a plus for the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else care to come to the podium and share some thoughts with us? We'd be more than anxious to hear what anyone has to say for information or opinion. Hearing no further comments from the public, I'll close the public hearing. And at this point in time, I'd invite the applicant to come back to the podium and perhaps go into some of the issues that were raised at last month's meeting.
I have about a dozen comments and questions that were raised by the planning board and was discussed to some extent last time, but we're looking now at answering those questions, and I'll just go down through them, and we can talk about each one as I go down through. probably that'd be the easiest way. The first question was consider removing spotlights in the lower parking lot since they cause glare in the motorists' eyes. These are there are two, I believe. One in this location here, which shines into the parking lot, and one in this location up here, which shines down at the parking lot in this direction. Our intent, right from the beginning, as some have spoken already, is to keep the project as concise as possible, and that's why we focused only on the upper lot. The upper lot is at the same level as the entry to the pool. Therefore, that's the place to put handicap parking in this area here. The lower lot, we've decided not to do anything to, basically, other than to improve a walk right here with a retaining wall because the building gets so close to it. But other than that, we're not doing any work to the lower lot. And that is the intent, if we can, and not to do work on the lighting, which if we start trying to upgrade the lower lot to the standards of the town center, we're looking at lighting, planting, islands, and then, again, the costs get out of control. As far as what we need, the upper lot satisfies the extra spaces that we need. Would you like to discuss that issue, or would you like me to go on to the next?
I think a good overview. We'll run right down through them.
Okay.
And then we'll...
The second, the question was made, should this project light an existing dark spot in the road at the building corner?
That would be around the corner in this area here of the existing drive. And again, it's the same philosophy that is not part of the project site. We're really trying to keep the project focused. And as we go back away from the parking lot that we're upgrading plus the building, we did not intend to keep on improving part of the high school road system or any other parts of it other than what's right here at the building expansion. Another question, the amount of seating, what amount of seating would the code allow based on the parking? Right now there's a total of 91 parking spaces. We're adding 12, so there'll be a total of 103 parking spaces. And as we compute that through the ordinance, we could have a total of 180 plus or minus seats. And we're providing 250, and that is the expanded expansion along this side of the building, which includes a set of bleachers that will seat about 250 people. So that's a little bit less than what the parking would allow. So we'll be a little on the conservative side there. Oh, I did. Oh. 280 seats is what the code would allow. If I said that wrong, 250 is what we're providing. The fourth question, compare the number of spectators currently standing versus the seating capacity. This has been done basically by those who have staff members at the swimming pool and at swimming meets, and that's what we have gotten for a count is about 250. That's why we're providing about 250 seats. Currently, there are that many people generally around the pool, standing around the pool, and that these seats would basically give them a place to sit down out of the way without increasing the number of people attending. The fifth question, consider bus parking lot and furnish a letter from the school department describing the bus use. We do have a handout on this issue. There's a letter discussing this.
Just to quickly go down, this letter is very brief. This is from Sue Weatherby. I am writing to clarify bus parking arrangements at the high school. When events, athletic or otherwise, are occurring at the high school, buses, regardless of where the event is taking place, are redirected to a lot at the front of the building for parking. Drop-off can occur at the front of the building, in the upper rear lot, or in the pool parking lot. To allow for emergency vehicle use, no buses are parked at the rear of the high school. So that, that basically explains what we talked about a little bit last time, but this is clarifying it. Therefore, we're not providing basically any parking for buses in either of these two lots. The buses will be then sent, once they're unloaded, back around to the front to park. Question number six, consider reducing the number of shrubs since they may not survive winter plowing. Those are shown on the planting plan. And basically, it's this group of shrubs right in here. There are some shrubs we're going to leave around the entry door and down the stairway. The rest of these that you see are larger trees. So it's that group of shrubs that we are going to remove from the plan. Question seven, try reducing the length of the proposed retaining wall. That's this retaining wall here that basically retains the earth near the corner of the expansion. And we've taken a look at it, and we can reduce it by probably about 15 feet without any trouble. So that will pull in the ends of the wall and just regrade the earth a little bit tighter, which should be no problem. Comment number eight, widen the driveway aisle behind the handicapped spaces since the propane tank is too close. The propane tank that we are showing is being relocated to that location, so we will push that even further back, but we are planning on adding, as shown on this lower drawing, if you can see the little red strip here, that is an expansion of that driveway that comes through to the full 24 feet width. We had reduced that a bit to make it blend into the walkway, but we're going to expand that to 24 feet and push the propane tank a few feet further back away from that. So, and there'll be some, I think there'll be some protective bollards there as well. So we will expand that and allow the vehicles to move easier in that area. Number nine, consider 250-watt light fixtures on 20-foot poles rather than 400-watt. Last time we talked about the proposal was 30-foot high poles with 400-watt fixtures, and that is, there are three of those that I've circled in red, the tall poles. The other one is a shorter 15-foot pole or 16-foot. The three poles, we did talk last time that we can reduce them to 20 feet without any degradation of the light on the pavement, but to reduce the wattage of the bulbs to from 400 down to 250 would not work. We'd have to introduce more poles or more heads on the fixtures, well no, actually more poles to get them closer to each other. And the way this is configured, that wouldn't work very well. Plus, we don't feel that there's anything wrong with 400-watt fixtures. They are the sharp cutoff conical type distribution. So we would rather not. We don't see a reason to reduce the wattage on those. We would end up with very good light distribution the way it's set. Number 10, are five handicap spaces enough for actual use? Five handicap spaces meet the ADA and main human rights requirements. And in discussing that with the people who use the pool and operate the pool, they feel that five handicap spaces is fine. That's plenty for this facility. 11, if swim meets occur off school times, is the parking, therefore, in the two lots fully available? The answer is no, it's not fully available because there are some other things, some other activities that do occur simultaneously. However, it's the current practice to reserve both lots as much as possible for a pool when there is a meet or a large group. The other comment is that there are, at that point in time when the school is not in session, there is a lot of parking out front, and they can open the doors in the front of the school and allow people to come through from that direction if there is an overcrowding and they need more parking. So that is currently the way they operate. Number 12, we had a discussion last time about the guardrail, and that we show along the top of the embankment, along both stretches of parking lot up here. That was not as much for a safety issue because the embankment is not very steep and it's grassed, but it was for a comment we had about vehicles driving up and down the bank. However, there was also a question from the Public Works Director as to snow plowing and where the snow would be stored. So in discussion with Public Works Director and with the pool committee, we've pretty much decided that we would take out the guardrail to allow the snow plowing and that the Public Works Department will take care of the maintaining the lawns as well as the snow, and they would much prefer not to see the guardrail in their way. And lastly, Patrick will mention a minor change to the exterior entry that we're making.
My name is Patrick Cost, and I'm the architect that's worked on this project virtually from the beginning. You've heard some of the challenges we faced maintaining our budget and program, and one of the ways that we've had to make a minor adjustment in order to accommodate the constraints is to redesign the entry into the facility to make it much more modest than was originally designed. The original design was a covered outdoor canopy area. It was a two-story element that was glass enclosed but on the top but was open. We have redesigned the entry so that there's that canopy has been removed and a small covered canopy entry has been substituted. That will allow the entry to function as was originally intended while allowing us to redeploy some of those dollars into other areas. We feel this is a modest structure, modest entries in keeping with that structure, and would ask the board to support this minor revision. Thank you.
So that is the list of comments that we heard at the last meeting, and since then, some of the discussions we've had. Where would you like to go from here?
Well, at this point, I think the board can begin some discussion. If we have further questions for you, hang on, we'll give you a holler. Do any board members have any questions immediately for the applicant before we go any further? Yes, Dean.
Maybe I missed this, but what was the purpose of changing the doorway, the entrance? Was it to save money?
Yes, as it was to save money. One of the comments that was made earlier by Mr. McGovern was that the site improvements that we've made exceeded our original projected budget. And so in order to, because we have a fixed budget, in order to compensate and balance it again, we've had to reduce the money that we were spending on the entryway and make it more modest. So it is a cost-saving measure.
I have a question, which may be simple. The in looking at the parking calculations for the project, something that would be good to know and just have sort of as a record in the application would be what the parking demand is for the facility. And since you have some parking lots which logically have been organized the way they should be, that you say would allow 280 seats, but you're really only providing 250 people, is it fair to say that the actual demand of the facility is about 10% less than the 103 spaces that are provided, that you could say this pool facility has a parking demand of 93 cars when fully utilized? Or was that 250 seats provided just the gallery seating? Or I mean, just as the town goes down the road, someday the question will come up, what is, you know, and instead of having another consultant hired to reevaluate something that was already done in the past, we could just sort of have this memorialized, and someday it'll come in handy.
Well, the it's been calculated a couple of different ways. When we first began, I think there was some questions about the overall high school lot. And again, we've tried to focus on just the pool's needs and not get into the discussion of the overall high school. The seating is we consider is actually not providing any space for more people, but it is providing a space for the people who are currently there at a pool meet who don't have a place to sit and are basically standing around. They have a place to sit where it's much more organized. There is an 1,100 square foot addition, which is an exercise room, that is not currently there. So we focused on that piece that is providing something new, and by the code that required 7.5 parking spaces, plus we put in an employee. So that bumped it up to, rounded off to 9 new spaces. That is the initial computation we made. And therefore, as we've reorganized the upper parking lot, and we've done a little bit at the lower one, we've lost 2 parking spaces in the lower lot because of the retaining wall, but we have gained 14, so it's a total of gain of 12 in the upper lot. So that satisfied that new building element that is being added to this site. That's one way of looking at it, and the way we've put it into the original application. Another way of looking at it is looking at the basically most of the pool facility as a assembly with which is based on the number of seating that you have, and taking out the weight room as I just mentioned, and taking out some of the area around the pool that people will wander around and stand in, and that reduces approximately, accounts for about 35 spaces. The remainder of the spaces then would be multiplied by 4 to get the number of seating allowable. We sort of work backwards from what we have here, and that's why we're saying they could seat about 270 to 280 people by that calculation when we're actually only providing seats for 250. So I know this is more confusing than most projects because it's existing and change of existing use. But both of those ways of looking at it still come out with the same bottom line, is we're adding a few more spaces than we need in either direction from either computation, which we think is a good thing to add a little extra.
This is heresy, but how much, in round figures, did the weight room cost? What's the...
Do you have that, Patrick?
Offhand. Ball field.
I'll explain, Mrs. Masterton, and how it was presented to the town council by the building committee back prior to the vote. There was an approximate cost differential of $400,000 from adding, just doing the pool, or adding some of the additional amenities, including the exercise room, a portion of the exercise room, and some of the seating. The difference was $400,000. However, it was felt by the committee in presenting the numbers to the town council that portion of the project would be self-supporting in the long run because of the revenue stream that would come from joint monthly fees for the combined facility of the pool, the exercise room, and the small whirlpools. So it's felt that portion is around $400,000 and that portion will be self-supporting because of the added feature of that will make this a more attractive facility. That answer your question?
So it was $400,000 including the equipment in the...
That's correct, right. And one of the issues we face is, you know, even if we wanted to reduce that at this point, that is what the citizens voted for. And you know from your experience as a legislator how important it is to follow exactly what you had indicated on a ballot question, how important it is to follow through on that.
It's their expectation.
Yes, it is, as well it should be.
Okay.
Any other questions? Yes, Steve.
Just one quick question. The propane tank that you mentioned, what is that used for? You know?
It is for the boilers. It feeds into the mechanical boiler room nearby. And although I'm not a mechanical engineer, as I understand it, it is for firing some of the boilers in for the school as a whole. And I believe it is also piping from the boiler room over into the kitchen as well and providing some energy for cooking in the cafeteria.
Thank you.
It's about 500 gallons. And the science labs.
Yes, Tom.
Through the chair, I have just a couple of questions. On the west elevation you show, I have this right. Maybe I'm looking at the wrong elevation. Anyway, there's looks like there's several sets of doors located. There's two sets of doors located behind the seating area. And that seating area has a lower floor elevation than I think the pool deck. Could you explain what the doors are for and the difference in elevation there?
Yes, the doors provide access to the space that's below the stadia seating, which will be used for two purposes. Its primary purpose is to provide storage for athletic field equipment, which is currently stored in other locations in the high school, actually in a hallway. Which we're restoring the function of that hallway as a hallway. So field hockey nets, things of that nature will be stored in that area. In addition, there will be a mechanical air handling unit underneath there, which will feed from beneath the seats above to provide some flow of air over the translucent panels that are above the seating area.
I was one that mentioned the issue of retaining wall. I know retaining walls aren't cheap, and I assume this is a precast block wall.
Yes.
If there's any way to save money, if that grading can be made steeper and some sort of planting or anything put on it to get rid of that wall, I would certainly, as a planning board member, wouldn't object to that at all. Someone who used to use the pool a lot, when you come into the building, where will the coats and jackets and all that be? Is that part of the situation that was lost with the change in the entrance design, or is that in the main lobby?
No, there's a current practice right now, which varies depending which locker room you're in. Mm-hmm. And our intent in the renovated locker rooms is to provide secure, lockable lockers that are functional for both men and women that will allow folks to, because it's a municipal pool, to store their belongings in a secure location. The coat storage for spectators or things of that nature is not being provided. The expectation is that people will wear their coats to the facility, and if they need to remove it in wintertime to be comfortable, they'll have it on the seat next to them.
How about, again, this is distantly related to the issue of pedestrian access to the building, but typically, and I guess particularly with pools, people entering the building this time of year, I'm particularly under this condition, come in with muddy boots and shoes on.
Yep.
Right now, they're required to hopefully sit down if you can find room. Store the boots and even shoes, let alone boots, in the lobby area with, mm-hmm. with the overcoats.
Mm-hmm.
What's the plan on that at this point?
There will be a product that's called Pedimat, number one. It'll provide a foot wipe area to try to get most of the sand, salt, snow off of people when they come into the lobby area. That current practice of removing shoes is a practice which grew out of the need for people to cross the pool deck in order to access locker rooms. And the reason that occurred was because the weight equipment that the high school has currently occupies one corridor, and the athletic equipment, which I referenced earlier, occupies and blocks the other corridor, which accesses the men's locker room. This is one of the most vigorously debated aspects of the renovation project, the whole traffic flow of people in and out of the building. And the original design anticipated all traffic coming from the high school itself, from internal traffic. And of course, the new traffic pattern that exists today prior to the renovation is an entirely different traffic pattern for most of the users. A number of schemes were looked at, including constructing a whole new corridor system that would separate the high school locker rooms from the pool locker room areas to provide a new way of accessing those areas. That was deemed too expensive an approach to use. So our current plan is that the women's locker room is configured in a way that allows women to enter the locker room off of the corridor. They come in the lobby space, they turn left, and they can enter their locker room directly. The men actually have the plan was to ask the men to use the originally designed route, which would require them to walk all the way around the locker complex. The folks at the facility felt that even though that technically would work consistent with the original design of the building, that as a practical matter, people would figure out the shorter way and continue to cross the deck. Consequently, a compromise was reached by reorienting the men's locker room so that there's a dry to wet pattern of traffic that needs to be accommodated, and allowing the men to continue to access across the pool deck, but to formalize a pathway with an appropriate walking surface for street shoes, and orienting the locker room so they enter into the dry end of that locker room. I don't think anyone is completely satisfied, but that will work effectively. It'll allow a safe passage, it's maintainable, and it's a vast improvement over the current situation. So shoes and coats will no longer be asked to be removed and stored in an unsecure manner in the hallways of the facility.
And the swimmers then would exit and re-enter the locker room from the lower entrance that's down at the bottom?
That is correct, yes.
I'm just getting up to speed on this. I apologize for taking time, but because we're comparing apples and apples, the configuration that you've shown us in terms of the pool hasn't changed size except that it's gained a handicap ramp?
That's correct.
And is the pool in its... in the same configuration, is it in the same hole in the ground as it is now, or is it moved toward the outside wall?
It has been moved slightly, and its dimensions have been modified to make it comply with NCAA guidelines, so that this will be a pool in which certified swim meets can occur.
I just can't figure out how. It looks like the distance from the inside wall to the handicap ramp or the accessible ramp and then to the edge of the pool lane is wider than the existing inside.
The pool has shifted towards the outside wall, where the window wall is currently.
Wider than the existing condition, but that's not my issue, obviously.
Yeah.
I think I raised a question about the buses last time. I have two students at the high school. Obviously, there's a parking issue. The students are as much of the part of the problem as everything else. Every student just about drives to school. During varsity events, the buses, I believe, according to memo, is correct, I see them everywhere, and there's parents will park anywhere they can fit a vehicle. And I liken that to sort of the Easter Sunday problem. There's no amount of pavement that's going to solve that problem. I think that's an inconvenience that everybody suffers through, whether they're going down to the Super Bowl for a, you know, the Super Bowl event, if they're going to a college football event. During college homecoming events, cars park everywhere. They park on the commons. They park. So for the occasional conflict where there's a difference, where you might have a varsity basketball game and a swim meet ongoing, that doesn't really trouble me too much, as long as it's clearly understood that right now the lower parking lot is signed. There are several spaces there that are designed exclusively for priority for pool use. Is that correct?
There's an attempt to reserve areas for pool parking, and my understanding is that it's still a competitive exercise.
That's all. Thank you.
Further questions? Yes, Dave.
I'm fairly convinced that the parking issue has been resolved, but I had one question for Mike McGovern. I was just curious if the town council is aware of our concerns relative to the lighting and the parking. Will that issue be addressed, in your opinion?
I have not had any discussions with the town council regarding the lighting. They do receive your minutes, and they probably are aware of it through that. As for the parking, the town council is aware of the concern. They live in the community like the rest of us do. There have been some discussions. We did do a parking master plan for the high school property several years ago. It provided for the addition of this parking lot, which subsequently was done. It provided for the expansion of up near where the teachers park, up as you exit the high school driveway, that new park, relatively new parking lot in back of Mr. Tinsman's property. It also provides, not yet built, a parking lot by the tennis courts, and a parking lot on the inside ground as you're going down around to the pool. It would be on the left on the community services wing side, and that shows about an additional 80 spots. So I should mention too, we did build that small parking lot as well, just as you're going down to the pool right on the right that the students park in. So it's something we're always looking at, the council's looking at, and you know, my hope would be that the next one we might address is to enhance the area below the tennis courts to accomplish quite a bit more parking there. They are aware of it, but they don't have immediate plans to add additional parking spots beyond what is in this plan.
Michael, while you're still there, do you have any plans for solving this gap problem?
The gap problem?
You suggest that we write a letter to the council, but yeah, the financial gap.
Yeah, the gap is in terms of if you look at the whole campus and the number of parking spaces we should have versus what we do have. You know, some of the, as Mr. Emery alluded to, you know, unfortunately we have more Easter Sundays than God does. And, you know, that is a problem. So, you know, I think my point is, if the board is concerned about the overall level of parking and the number of spaces, I would prefer that you ask the council specifically to think about the issue and to look at it, rather than to unilaterally require additional parking beyond these additional 12 spaces at this point in time. That's the point.
Can you tell me, are all of the kids who are able to drive eligible to park in that upper parking lot where the kids park?
There are some in the room that are more familiar with I am as to where students are told to park. You know, there's a senior lot, there's an underclassman's lot, there's a teacher parking lot.
But driving to school is not a privilege that, I mean, we're all paying for buses, right? Driving to school is not a privilege for juniors and seniors or seniors.
Yes, my understanding is there is no prohibition on anyone who has a driver's license from being able to go onto the school grounds and to park.
Has that ever been addressed as an issue?
There's been a parking committee within the school department that has looked at that issue. But most of it is, you know, even I remember the principal this year, I think it was this fall, although the years get blurry after a while, had actually proposed assigning students to their own unique parking spot. And, you know, we didn't want to do that because, you know, you have so many students absent each day and you don't want empty parking spots. It is constantly looked at. The other issue is we look up at the middle school, the big lot up there above the lacrosse field. On any given day, there's about 50 empty spots up in that lot. And that's one of the things that we hold out to look at, is perhaps if we ask some of the underclassmen, you know, if you want to drive to school, fine, but you're going to have to walk a little bit of a distance.
They don't want that, do they?
Well, it's the reason we haven't pushed the issue is because when they, even though 95% of the time those 50 spots are open, 5% of the time there's some activity within the schools that, you know, the kids are putting on some sort of performance, and the parents depend on those 50 spots to be able to come in for that. So that's the reason we haven't done it. But we're always looking at different options, and, you know, I've thought of everything, you know, from if students carpool and have so many, you know, they ought to be able to park in the advantage lots, trying to, you know, just much as the state has looked at in the PACS region of having incentives for carpooling, incentives that we don't have to put in more pavement and have more traffic.
Thanks.
If you'd like to volunteer to serve on a committee to look at that, I'd be happy to accept your offer.
Mr. Wilcox?
Yes, Peter.
In defense of our students, I'd like to just remind the public that during certain times of the year, over 70% of the students at our high school are involved in extracurricular activities, which are not normally scheduled at a period of time when after-school transportation on school buses is available. Also, many of our juniors and seniors only attend school for part of the day. It's not that they're dismissed early, it's just that they attend classes elsewhere, either at USM or one of the other college campuses. Many of our students go to the Portland Technical School. Many of our students also go to SMTC. These people need their own transportation to get to these classes. And this is not uncommon in Cape Elizabeth. It is really very common. Matter of fact, if you want parking available to you, if you visit the high school lots in early afternoon, you'll find empty spaces because many of the students have left and are attending school elsewhere. Thank you.
Any other board comments?
No, Tom. Can we make a motion?
I just have one quick question. How many girls would you anticipate would be using the girls' locker room at any one time? I'm counting the number of showers in here, and I'm pretty blown away, actually. 35 showers in the girls' locker room.
It's rather discriminatory, don't you think, Steve?
Huh?
It's rather discriminatory.
Well, since the men all have to go into one big closet to take a shower.
Yeah. It varies. The number of showers in the women's locker room is inadequate. That's recognized by, at times, that's recognized by everyone on the committee. The constraints of the existing locker room layouts, the space we had to work within, ADA requirements, other programmatic elements which needed to be inserted into that locker area have limited us to 7 showers. The approach that is used when demand exceeds the available number of showers is that the adjacent locker rooms are opened and people are given access and allowed to use those shower areas so that the need for additional capacity is met by using the existing adjacent locker rooms.
Mr. Parkhurst was counting the pool. He was counting 35 locks. He was counting both locker rooms.
Oh, I'm sorry. As far as the men's locker room?
Well, no, it says on the plan.
Oh, I see. I see what you're saying. I'm sorry. I misunderstood your question. Have I answered your question sufficiently, or can I clarify?
I'm not sure. It just seems like, I mean, girls can't wait. I mean, I'm not trying to be...
No, I understand. This is...
35 showers seems like a lot.
Well, how many showers are there now? There's a lot more than 35.
There, in the current women's locker room layout, there are 10 showers. We're reducing that number by 3. So the total number of showers available has been reduced by 3 in order to accommodate things such as handicap accessible toilets. We're restoring the lockers that were removed from the women's locker room that had been removed in its entirety and replaced with a bench. And patterns of use are such that in an extensive debate that went on for probably more than 90 minutes one night, we talked about patterns of shower use amongst different sexes and whether, in order to increase capacity, we would change the arrangements, which provide essentially a changing drying area outside of the women's shower rooms. And the consensus of the group was that that would not be an acceptable approach. So unfortunately, we were constrained in our ability to increase the capacity of the showers. With the access to the adjacent locker rooms, demand can be satisfied and has been, as I understand it.
Thank you.
Yes, Tom.
I'd like to make a motion. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the town of Cape Elizabeth for an expansion of the community pool located at the rear of the high school be tabled to the regular February 16th, 1999 planning board meeting. And my understanding is the reason for doing that is that the drawings haven't been revised per the engineer's comments at the last meeting. I think, I certainly hope that the committee isn't being forced to scrimp on the mechanical systems either for the pool or for the air handling because of the site issues. It's not unusual in many building projects that a site component be about 10% or 8 to 10% of the overall project, whether it's an addition, new construction, and of course that varies whether you're putting in a whole brand new driveway or is this project just doing a relatively small addition. So you can see how out of whack the site component is to the overall project cost by budgeting $50,000, and that's not a criticism of the committee at all. So I don't think that there's room to cut the site any further to go along with the building. And I know building prices are out of whack, so I'm very sympathetic to the building committee's plight in trying to meet the budget and the design team's plight. I would, however, since it goes back to the middle school project, request through the town manager's office. I'm not sure that the planning board's purview to lobby the town council, but I'm particularly concerned about the issue behind the high school where there's what I consider inadequate light. When you come around that corner, one of the primary reasons is that a lot of these facilities are used after hours. And I don't know what that means, Mike, whether we have a workshop meeting and a representative of the school department comes and presents their parking plan to us and at least acknowledges how those lighting issues will be dealt with in the future. Because now we've missed the opportunity with the middle school project. The planning board really only has the opportunity when applications come before it to look at these issues, and to continue to defer something like that I think is maybe a little bit not good on our part, and certainly I think is an issue that this planning board's been concerned about now since the early 1990s to middle 1990s. So I'd at least as a condition of approval like to see some positive action, whether it's a notice to the school department or to the facilities manager or however that might be handled.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You want me to second your motion?
Go ahead, then we'll have
second.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second, and now some discussion.
Just very briefly, the town government is now responsible for the school grounds. all of the expense, none of it comes out of the school budget. So, you know, if we do need that, well, certainly we will consult with the school department. The town council, out of the municipal budget, funds all of those expenses. So, you know, I give you my assurance that I'll talk to you sometime after this issue is resolved, you know, so that we don't get into a situation of ex parte communication to further that discussion and to see what we might be able to do.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion? I have a question for the applicant regarding the revised height of the poles. Would it be possible for us to see revised photometrics also? I'm concerned about overlighting those parking lots at this point using the same 400-watt fixture 10 feet lower. We really don't need to read books out there.
Yeah, I do have with me a, I believe it's, I grabbed the right one. Let me check. I didn't grab the right one.
Well, that's okay.
We do have one that we did before the last meeting, and it wasn't, didn't have time to discuss it, but we do have one that we did. The lighting is not, if I remember right, it was not overly intense, but it was very adequate. Mm-hmm. You know, it was, I believe, in one half a foot candle to one and a half foot candles. And then, of course, when you get right near the base of a light, you're going to get a lot, you know, 5 foot candles or more, but in general, the lighting, when we reduce the height of the poles, which reduces the spread of each particular fixture, we had to add a second head to the pole in the center because it was a single head, and we had to add one in each direction in order to get that spread. We kept a very similar amount of lighting.
Okay. And would it be possible also to have a parking demand for this facility tabulated based on what the fire chief would say is an allowable occupancy? I'm glad to see that we have conservatively met the demand for the facility with these adjacent lots. We're not trying to push this project out beyond the realm of the pool facility itself, but I believe that this application should document what the demand of this building is for parking. And we're sure you can meet it.
For the pool building, for the pool facility only.
For the pool facility.
Not the whole high school.
Right, no, not for the whole high school. And I think it seems a little exaggerated to think of a pool as some place where you only leave a little area around the edges and just assume that in a heavy swim meet you've got chairs set up at the rear of the decks. I mean, places where you intend for people to sit, you know, what would the fire chief like to see for a normal occupancy based on the areas you've got, and then translate that into parking, and then we'll know. You may have even more surplus parking there than you think. Mm-hmm. Any other questions or discussions from board members? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion indicate by raising your right hand. Motion passes, and we'll look forward to seeing you next month. Great. Next item on the agenda is the Sprague Master Subdivision Plan, a request by the Sprague Corporation for final subdivision approval, resource protection permit, and private access waiver for a 62-lot subdivision located south of Our Road, reviewed under Section 16-2-4C, Section 19-8-3, and Section 19-7-9. We'll have the applicant come to the podium and assemble their materials.
Mr. Chairman, as in the past, I'll recuse myself from any discussion on this.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Good evening, and please introduce what's on the board this evening.
Don't really need much of an introduction, I hope. My name is Terry DeWan, landscape architect of Yarmouth, representing Sprague Corporation. With me tonight is Seth Sprague from Sprague Corporation, John Green, property manager, Amy Bell Siegel, landscape architect of my office. Since last time, a couple of things have happened. Of course, we've submitted a memo to the planning board dated January 4th, 1999, and in it we talked about another number of items that were carryovers from the last planning board meeting in December on the 15th. These were elements of the plan that the board had asked us to address specifically. First of all, the whole issue of the phasing plan, and we'll get into that in a moment. And we've given you both a narrative and drawings, and we've colored up a copy of it for discussion tonight. We have a discussion on the performance guarantee issue, and also we've received additional correspondence from Les Berry from BH2M and the town's engineer relative to some of the issues that we talked about from a more technical standpoint. Les has talked to Steve over the last couple of days. We talked to Les today. From our understanding of the last discussion, Les Berry had presented a very involved letter looking at 23 or 24 different elements. And as of the last meeting, it was our understanding there were two elements that still were outstanding. One had to do with the section of the roadway relative to the type of gravel that would be used. And second had to do with monumentation. We talked to our engineer today. We talked to the town's engineer, and it's our understanding that there is an agreement that the detail that's outlined in Les Berry's letter is suitable to meet his concerns, with the condition that if the road were ever to be paved, that the type D gravel that we're proposing to be used throughout the roads, which is typically the type of gravel that is used right now, would have to be overtopped with type A gravel if the road ever were to be paved, which is not the intent, but that's just a stipulation that the town engineer is recommending. The second issue had to do with monumentation, and if you recall, the town's engineer requested that some additional monumentation be included as part of the plant. Les Berry has gone back and added some monumentation, and apparently the degree of monumentation is in agreement with the town's engineers. I have not talked to the town engineer directly, maybe Maureen has, but that's the understanding that I have in talking with Les today. So from our perspective, at least, in both talking with Les and looking at the review letter that we got from the town engineer, that that whole litany of issues that were raised have been addressed to his satisfaction. And this is outlined in Steve Harding's letter of January 12th that talks about those 23 issues. So if you have any questions on that, glad to answer them. And if not, we go into the phasing plan.
If any board members have questions regarding the technical points of review with the town engineer at this point?
Two questions I have.
Yes, Dave.
I think that Mr. Harding made some comments on a plan originally that he gave to Mr. Berry. I just was wondering if those were all going to be transferred onto the final plan that will be presented.
Yes, they will be.
Okay. And I got a second question regarding the aprons on Breakwater and I'm thinking of the other entrance that's on Route 77 is...
Ice Pond Road.
Pardon me?
Oh,
Monastery Road. I've looked at the road since the time that we had our last meeting, and I would like to request that we reconsider and have you relook at the possibility of putting an apron in there on both of those. And the reason why I make that comment is, or request, I am a bike rider, and it is a problem. And I think that's why the town has made it an ordinance to put aprons on those kind of roads. When you come down Route 77 and you come to Monastery Road, there is always gravel in the bike lane. And the natural reaction of a biker is to skirt that. And I ride it 3 or 4 times a week in the summertime, and I'm aware of it. And I think that something ought to be done in that area along with Breakwater, because that also has some gravel in it. And I would like to ask the panel or the planning board if we might reconsider that one issue.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that from other board members?
Well, if there is a bike lane there, I'd forgotten about that. That's for bikers. And if the gravel is dangerous to bikers, I'd be willing to reconsider.
Let me explain the issue again a little bit more hypothetically. You come down the hill there approaching Monastery as a single biker. Normally, you approach that kind of a facility at a speed that you're going down that hill, and you tend to turn left to avoid it. Most of the time you will look to see if a car is in the traveling lane, because you'll enter the traveling lane. My thought is that just the one time somebody forgets to look in the traveling lane and there's a car coming. And that's specifically, I think, why the town has that ordinance for aprons approaching, for many other reasons, but I would think that that's an issue that we should reconsider.
If I may indulge the board.
Yes, please.
My name is John Green. I'm the property manager. I also am a cyclist. I think I put about 1,000 miles a year in Cape Elizabeth roads alone. I agree with Dave that there are sections of the roads where gravel is a problem. That bike lane in particular, I do not even ride on the whole bike lane. The bike lane itself is in disrepair. I think perhaps we could, in fact, agree, if the board thinks so, to put those paved aprons in. I would almost prefer to see less than 50 feet of an apron to accomplish the same goal without impacting the full area, just to get rid of the gravel. If that's an opportunity, that'd be great. If not, I think we could live with some aprons. I just don't like to see seas of pavement 50 feet deep out there, if we can accomplish it maybe with something less. But I agree there is a bit of a problem, as there are in many spots in town, so we'd be happy to hear what you have to say and agree with it.
Yes, Dave.
I think less than 50 feet would be permissible, but I think there has to be something in there to stop that gravel from getting in the bike lane.
What about... ice. What about the road that's going to be closest to the Spurwink River? That's not developed yet.
We've agreed to build that town standard with the apron.
I beg your pardon?
That will be built to the standards of the town.
That will be?
Yes, there will be.
Okay. Are there any other roads that access onto 77 there?
Well, other than the town road, just the two roads that we've talked about already. Maybe we could, you know, pick up on what John is talking about. And I totally agree that a 50-foot length of pavement going in there, you know, make it seems like an extension of the town road. And I think it may invite people to come in. And what we're really looking for is a widened area where a car can stop and then accelerate onto the to the roadway without kicking up gravel. You all know that I'm a bicyclist also. And I would just suggest that something in the vicinity of, say, 15 to 20 feet, enough for a car to stop, be able to look both ways, essentially paving it back to the inside of the radius, would certainly seem to be suitable in this case.
I can't comment exactly. I think the town engineer or the Public Works people would probably give you an idea on that. I can't really comment exactly. Somebody else might be able to. I don't think, personally, I don't think 50 feet is necessary to accomplish the elimination of the gravel.
If I think perhaps if we could get at least an understanding from the planning board, we are nearing the end of this whole process, and it would be nice to at least, if we could work with the town engineer, if it's not possible, if you think a further decision needs to be made, then perhaps we could agree to something tonight. If it's the full 50 feet, so be it. If you think we could accomplish something less that would be, you know, work for both of us, that would be even better. But we would like at least a little input from the board as to how you feel about the issue.
You heard my input. I have no idea whether 50 feet or 25 feet or 15 feet would be adequate. I don't know. I mean,
well, as a cyclist, I've seen many instances where there are 3-foot paved portions outside of what the town has paved that has worked. I don't know if we're going to get a direct answer. I know Public Works would want to see the full 50 feet, and perhaps we just will just accept the 50 feet and move on to the next issue. We're willing to do that.
I think realistically, though, you know, 15 or 20 feet, you know, essentially the length of a car.
25, half.
Common sense. 25 going once. 25 certainly makes sense.
I mean, I don't know. I have no idea what would be adequate. But 50 feet does seem
well. But if you think of it as if a car needs a car length to roll and have all its dirt shed, then two car lengths would do it, and that's 40 feet. Well, that's almost 40 feet, so you're getting close to 50 right there from the edge of the traveled way. There's not that much difference there. But that's just intuitive. Yes, Dave?
Yeah, I think 25 feet would be adequate.
You do?
Most cars are 15 feet. Wheelbases are less than that. So.
Mm-hmm.
My two cents would be somewhere between 25 and 40 feet. So I guess this has to be in a book someplace. I'm sure you can pull it out and say, okay, the tires will clean themselves if they're cleanable, and then it won't shed dirt onto the pavement. Mm-hmm. You think during the construction, with trucks going in and out, they are going, no matter how long it is, they're going to kick dirt out into 77.
Yeah, it's a much different situation, though, than the day-to-day use that we're talking about here. Well, to get beyond this, can we say 30 feet? And
Maureen?
Well, the board seems to be looking for an expert, and I would like to suggest that you've had two experts give you a recommendation. That's the Public Works Director and the town engineer. They both said 50 feet. 50 feet is the standard in the ordinance. I still hear the Public Works Director kid about the one apron the board approved at 35 feet. You know, we have standards in the ordinance for a reason, and it makes it a lot easier to enforce the approvals the board puts in the plans if we try to be consistent. And if you're looking for an expert opinion or something in a book, you've got two people who've given you an opinion.
Mm-hmm. that's
we will
another,
live with 50.
That's another
50
way of looking at it also.
Wish of the board. That's we still think it's excessive.
So be it. How's that?
Certainly entertain any suggestions of a lesser amount, though. Well, why don't we move on to the phasing plan? There's no further comments on any of the other engineering components. Now, the phasing plan, of course, consists of a number of different documents. There is the phasing plan narrative that we've supplied you with, the summary on the second and third, first and second pages of our January 4th letter. There is a performance guarantee summary, which describes in a lot of detail each of the 16 phases that would occur over the life of the build-out. And there is also two drawings that we gave to you, which comprise the drawings of the phasing plan. And Maureen and I have chatted about this off and on the last couple of weeks. I know that Maureen has gotten out her own colored pencils and suggested a way we might consolidate looking at the phasing plan. The design team met today and revisited the whole situation, and the result is the diagram on the left, which is, I hope, an attempt to meet the criteria that the town seems to be looking for in coming up with a phasing plan that, in one easily understood document, explains how the roadways would be improved and how lots might be developed over the life of the project. Let me briefly, since I know that I've made this presentation at least twice before, explain what we're trying to do with this diagram on the left here. What we've done is divided the overall 1,500 acres into three major components. We're saying 1A, or the yellow portion, which is the majority of the property, 1B, the green portion on the east side, and phase two up here. And when we say phases, we're not, and I have to repeat that, we're not implying that they will be developed or built in the order that we're numbering them. We've talked about maybe numbering them 1 through 16 or A through Z or assigning colors to them, but they will happen when lots are in demand. Right now, as we've said, and I'm sure you'll hear Seth talk about later on, we have no plans, the family members have no plans to build anything out there right now. So we're not looking to trigger any activity out there that would say that this is going to be the first phase. We're simply looking at this as a way of getting a handle on what things would be built in which order, according to the performance guarantee summary. As you know from the last year's worth of discussion, we're talking about an emergency through road. That essentially makes a big loop that does that, uses a variety of public and private roads. Some private roads that would be upgraded, some private roads would be left in their existing conditions because they've been deemed to be acceptable by the town. Phase one, the yellow zone in through here, is what we're saying is the north and west through road. And as we've said in our narrative, that if any of the lots that fall within this yellow zone and these various colors are proposed to be built upon, then the improvements that are proposed for the combination of Charles Jordan Road to Monastery Road and through here would be made according to the details of the plan. The plan, of course, includes all 78 pages of drawings that we've supplied you with. Secondly, the 1B, this area over here, what we're calling the East Through Road, again, there are four lots, lots 9 and 10, that have some potential, or six lots, rather, to trigger the development of this area. These, of course, are improvements to Breakwater Road, Little Pond Road, and a portion of Monastery Road that essentially would give us that portion of the emergency access loop for that part of the property. Ice Pond Road, of course, operates as its own separate entity. It's like the big iceberg up there. unto itself. Those six lots off of Bowery Beach Road would not trigger any of the improvements to the emergency access road. And we've had that discussion. I think everybody's in agreement with that. What we're calling phase three in terms of our submittal to the town are what we're calling the other improvements. After the improvements were made to the emergency loop road system, then the improvements would be made to the various other either small segments or larger segments of roads as we've described it. There are triggering mechanisms that we've described in here, but as simply as possible, that's how we're proposing to deal with the phasing plan, both in a narrative fashion and in a graphic fashion. I would turn it back to you for any comments on the phasing plan issue.
Any questions from board members on phasing plan? Everybody completely clear?
When we did the initial submittal, we had two diagrams, which we've now morphed into one, which is the one on the left. One on the right showed what lots triggered which action, which I think is a very useful diagram. And as Maureen pointed out today, we really should have connected this black line in through here to make sure that we got all of what was considered part of the loop road for phase 1A.
Would it be okay if I refer to the colors at this point instead of the...
We would prefer that you refer to them by the green zone.
In terms of asking questions?
Yes.
Because I think the overall approach of, let's just say, the yellow versus the green, each requiring a loop, is clear. Everybody follow that part? Any lot within those areas? Go back again, because I think I may have missed this part. Say, within the yellow, if a red, green, or purple is developed, does that trigger the same loop road requirements as the yellow itself? Or are those independent?
Well, we're saying that the yellow, we'll have the discussion in the following sequence of discussion here. The improvements made for yellow would only happen once somebody within the family wanted to pull a building permit, and that triggers the start of construction.
So if I pulled a red building permit, would that trigger the loop road requirements for yellow?
That's absolutely right.
So red is completely a subcategory of yellow.
Yeah, think of this as being two layers.
The numbers can work sometimes.
They can, okay. Right. But once you know, the green or the pink or the purple pulled the building permit, you know, all those improvements would be made, which makes it a lot easier for subsequent people to pull their building permits.
In terms of what those improvements are, does everybody have a handle on that at this point? Which fire ponds exactly, which roads, or would there be notes added to the plan that would describe that?
I think those are all submitted, again, at that 78 pages worth of detailed drawings, as well as the work that John Seth put together, which is this diagram here, which, again, going back to this numbering and lettering system here, describes the name of the road, the description of the road, the work to be performed, the references, the plan and profile sheets. It talks about which lots trigger that particular action. And we're also showing the estimated, or a form for estimating the cost to do that. This is the formula that would be used to determine the performance guarantee.
So it's not just the loop road within the yellow, but all of the work within the yellow. So if somebody pulled a building permit on red, would you build a road over on purple?
Just the road for that house, right. Right, right. If you know, purple lot here was the first one to pull the building permit, right, it would trigger, you know, the loop road improvements, plus whatever was necessary to get improvements just for that particular portion, the purple portion.
Oh, okay. So it's not but all it, of the drive.
Yeah,
it's not
this,
all of.
Yeah, pulling that a building permit there does not trigger all the other improvements.
When you mentioned all of the 76 sheets of drawings being triggered by that one building permit, it made my ears go up a
no,
little bit.
No.
I didn't think that was what you meant.
No, we're essentially triggering this red line right here.
Okay.
Okay.
Are you triggering the red line or everything in yellow?
Well, it's primarily the red line, because everything in yellow includes all those secondary triggering mechanisms, those Category 3 improvements.
That seems to tie the road network in fairly well and address the roads, but the fire ponds are sort of on a different schedule. Is it possible to address those on a second phasing plan, or somehow or other another sub-layer of the first phasing?
That's on drawing number 4 that we have.
Because I know they're all described.
There's
in terms
a schedule that tells exactly when those will be built or improved.
Are those on a schedule to be built regardless of whether or not the road lots are developed?
Somebody should have a mini set of drawings on page 4, I believe.
Okay.
On the lower left-hand side, there is... Yeah, and that's a 7-year schedule starting in 1999.
I don't see dates. I see descriptions.
It talks about
Corner Pond in 1999.
Right. And I believe in our application.
Marines.
Okay.
They're not the same.
Could the dates for the fire ponds be added to the plan
rather
than just be in the narrative? But basically, what would be really good for sort of having a working document rather than a pile of our applications, we all take them and throw them out. And I know they don't throw them out at town hall, but I believe having something that would be one set of documents that would then have all of this sort of incorporated into it would be
sure it's right on the tip of your
invaluable. That's in my other pile that I left at home, I think.
Anyway, we do say here, as we point out, the Corner Pond would be done this year, and going on to to lots year 7 at the ultimate end, improvements of Japanese Pond.
So
unless there were lots that needed those improvements beforehand.
Sooner. Okay. How do other board members feel that that's a...
I'm totally confused.
An adequate description?
We have a map up there. We have a map in front of us. They're different colors. But I assume that the regions are the same. In other words, you have a big region over on the right-hand side. We have a brown thing.
Oh, you're looking at more reads?
Yeah. Because I can't see that. It's too far away. Yeah. Okay. Now,
they are almost identical.
Yeah, I can see they're not quite. But may I ask through you, Maureen, a question?
Yes.
What are these 3A... Roman numeral 3A3, Roman numeral A, 3A2, etc. They seem to be all threes. Roman numeral 3.
What they are is the applicant's effort to number the phases. And your confusion has been shared by town staff. It was the request of the town engineer and I that we use a much more simple numbering plan, like phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4, instead of using these 3A sub-phase numbers, because what the applicant is trying to do is create a major phase and break it into smaller phases and then have sub-phases of that And at that point, what the town engineer and I are saying is this is becoming much too complex for the people that are currently working on it to understand. How are we going to understand it in a year or in 5 years, or when we're not here and someone else has to understand what was the will of the planning board? My other concern is, and I can't think of a technical way to describe this, so I will put it in the simple terms that I talked to Mr. Dewan earlier today. And my belief is that a phasing plan should be so simple that you can close your eyes, stick your finger on the plan, open your eyes, and know what phase you're in. And I'm very concerned that we're trying to distinguish between loop road improvements and phase improvements, and a separate schedule for the fire pond versus the rest of the phasing. Again, it's very complicated. And the more complex it is, the easier it will be to not correctly construct this plan as the board intended it to be constructed.
Okay. Now let me ask you another question. Why is everything three? Roman numeral three.
I believe the applicant's intent was that all of the phases that begin with Roman numeral three rely on the first proposed loop road to be constructed.
That's correct. Improvements to the loop road.
Okay.
So
I know what that
threes
means.
Follow ones, and two stands by itself.
Except for 3B1. I guess the Bs are the other loop road.
Well, I see nothing but threes. Roman numeral three.
There's three.
I don't see any Roman numeral twos.
That's up in the upper left-hand corner here.
Well,
let's not mark an hour.
You didn't mark.
There were two. What I did, the applicant submitted two phasing plans, and I just took one of them for purposes of using the color.
Another reason why we used the Roman numerals is that initially, remember, there are 10 big lots underlying all of this, and we thought that may add to the confusion by having, you know, phase three on lot four.
Well, why didn't you just use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? Not Roman numerals, but. I just don't understand the system.
I understand this is extremely complex, and in fact, today I made another attempt to try to put together a numbering system. It is a difficult situation to understand. We would be happy to number everything sequentially, 1 through 16 or 1 through however many number of phases there are, with the understanding that perhaps something such as a loop road, if it was phase one, so to speak, that we still have the problem of requirements of roads within the yellow area. Would not only trigger the loop road, but would in fact trigger the road going to that lot. So we have a situation that this is such a large piece of property and complex enough that trying to number it different ways, we still come out with something that is a little bit difficult to grasp, hence the coloring. I think we can come back to the board with a sequentially numbered document. If you follow it through as we have it listed here and just sequentially number it 1 through 20 or whatever it happens to be, we'd be happy to do that and keep it that simple. It's not going to change the phasing aspect. It's just maybe an easier way, perhaps, for the board to see 1 through 20 instead of 3, 1A, 3, 1B, and we'd be happy to provide that.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Alex.
As a further point of what's been said and to work in the objection Maureen has, it seems to me that it might save some time if each lot was given the phases that would have to take place for that individual lot. Now, bear in mind that many of these would be triggered with the first lot in that green area or in the yellow area, so that at a follow-up lot, that wouldn't be necessary. You see what I mean?
I agree. And in fact, if we read through the text that we provided you and don't look at, you know, 3.1a, 3.1b, and went down through the phasing plan text and literally read, like as you had mentioned, each lot, we have explicitly stated by lot what happens if, you know, if that lot permit were pulled.
I think that Maureen's point is that 5 years from now, when one of these lots is pulled, then there may be a lot of head scratching as to just what has to be done. But if it's lined up for each individual lot, you could say, well, we already did that. We already did the loop road. We already did the access road because the lot next to it went up. And so that all we have to do now is X, Y, and Z.
Okay, we just developed a little matrix right here. Okay, having three columns. One's primary loop road, emergency loop road. The second column would be secondary road improvements required, and the third vertical column would be pond improvements required. So it would look something like this. So if someone wanted to pull a building permit on lot two, they would know that you have to make this improvement right here first, and then make this improvement right here, and then this pond would have to be.
Sounds good.
Does that seem to work?
Nancy.
Yes, anything that would.
I think it's just a way of reorganizing this information.
My key brain could understand would be much appreciated. But the other question I have is, I understand the loop road. Do you have plans to improve that immediately or in the very near future, or are you waiting to trigger that by some building out?
The latter, and that's what we intend to
the
talk
ladder.
About, yes, the next few minutes.
Hmm?
That's our next point of discussion with the board.
Oh, okay.
The triggering mechanisms, performance guarantees, and so forth.
Do board members understand that if the lots are sequentially numbered, it doesn't mean they're sequentially built, and that this presents no confusion?
No,
as long as there's a note somewhere saying that, well, I think Terry's approach of a matrix that shows
we
what's required
what
to be done, if they come in a different order and you look on a chart that says this has to have been done, but lo and behold, it's already been done because
yeah.
it was done in a different sequence, then you know it's not necessary to do it again.
I know that Maureen has
so
given
that
us
seems,
a copy
that seems
of,
reasonable.
Of Dominicus Crossing, which had five different phases. Of course, those will be done sequentially at some point.
If you remember, Terry, the last two phases, you had the option of which one you wanted to go first. You could actually do them both at the same time. So just because you number a phase 1, 2, 3 doesn't mean it can't be built 1, 3, 2.
Yep.
Okay.
It's not talking about dates when we say 1, 2, 3, or a sequence 1, 2, 3, are we? We're just placing it on the map.
Right. It's
is that right?
It's a construction sequence plan. Maybe that's another way of looking at it.
Oh.
Well, it's more of an area. It's just areas on the face
maybe,
of the earth.
Maybe phase of plan is the wrong term. Maybe we need to come up with some different.
Okay.
Anyway, I think that we're on the right track, though, with this matrix about what has to happen in which order.
Okay. Next topic, please.
One introduction to this. Steph is going to have a few words of introduction.
Well, I was prepared to, my name is Seth Sprague, of the corporation and the family, and I was just prepared to speak about what Mrs. Masterton raised about, you know, our plans as to whether or not we're going to start right away. And I think I've made it clear in the past that we were intending this as a future plan, and that when there was a change in use triggered by a new home, that's when we would start all this.
Yeah.
And I'd be happy to talk about that, or if it's an issue.
I understand that.
I don't think
if it's not an issue, let's not talk about it.
While you're up there, I wonder if could we move to the issue that Maureen has raised, and I'm sure you're familiar with, limiting the sale of the lots, if you will, or the building on the lots to family members, and I'd like to get your mm-hmm. feelings on that.
Is this the appropriate time to move on to the conditional approval? happy to talk about it.
Yes.
The planning board has been willing to grant certain waivers to the Sprague Corporation on the basis that we were presenting a long-term family land use plan, and that this is not a typical subdivision available for immediately for sale to the public. And as such, it's reasonable for us to provide provisions in the plan for planning board review of the plan should the property ever become a public non-family owned property. And that's what we're providing for in the language of the conditional approval, that we're making part of the plan. What this condition of approval deals with is the review that would be triggered by the change from a family land use to a public project. This condition of approval language doesn't apply in any way to this or any future planning board's authority to review all aspects of the subdivision should the Sprague Corporation want to come back to amend it. I mean, this doesn't deal with that at all. But in drafting this language, we had to try to look forward and try to anticipate what the impact might be and under what circumstances a review of the plan, how it might come about. And we're trying to plan for the future here. And what we basically see is that there are two basic scenarios that might come to pass if the property and the plan ever became available to the general public. And one is that it's sold in its entirety by the corporation, and then in that case, the entire property that's covered by the amendment to the subdivision would be subject to review by a future planning board, because in this language, if it's sold to a non-family member, that review happens. You have all your opportunity to review any waivers that were granted because we were a family land use plan. The other scenario, which in our view is hopefully not likely to happen, but more likely than the first, is that you can envision that sometime in the future, the corporation may have changed shape and the property becomes owned directly by individual family members rather than by a corporation. So what happens if the corporation has distributed this land to family members and a family member decides at that time to take their lot and sell it to a non-family member? And that's what we're addressing in the plan, where we're suggesting that in that event, the plan will be reviewed within the large major subdivision lots that caused that triggering event. For example, if this lot is sold over here, it's part of lot 10, this big lot here. So that sale would trigger a review of this whole lot, and the planning board at that time would be able to impose whatever conditions it wanted on that part. But what we're suggesting is that if this happens, it would be better not to review the entire parcel, because you could have at that time someone up 2 miles away over here happily living within the subdivision rules at that time, and because this lot is sold over here, they would be dragged into a review of the plan, and their road may be required to be widened. They may have to have affordable housing. They may have to create open space. And we believe that for four reasons that our suggested language for the conditional approval is appropriate. One, for issues of basic fairness. Two, for the ease of future administration of the subdivision. and three, because it involves no ultimate loss of planning board capacity to impose open space, affordable housing, or any other conditions over the entire property. And four, I believe that our plan will mitigate the potential for accelerated future development of the property in this instance of an ultimate sale outside the family. And if I could just review those four things quickly, the basic fairness issue is the one that I was just alluding to, where you could have people living 2 miles apart. They're technically within the same subdivision, but unless you limit the review to the large lots, it would seem to put an unfair and unnecessary burden on unrelated parties. And this leads to a potential for a very difficult administrative situation if our plan isn't adopted. Our plan will limit the interested parties to a change to the plan to those in the immediate vicinity of the change. And you won't be dragging in unrelated, distant neighborhoods. Under our proposal, the planning board would not relinquish its authority to impose public development standards on the property in the future, but only establish an orderly method for applying them. We don't believe that there would be any net loss in ability to impose affordable housing, open space, or any other provisions in the future. They would just be applied incrementally. The smallest and the most densely developed major lot in our plan, Lot 6, consists of 32 acres, and only 11 acres of it is encompassed in lots, newly created lots. Just a third of that, the smallest and most densely developed parcel. And there's ample space, even in this one, to impose all the future requirements. And at the end, if all the major lots involved had a public sale to a non-family member, the town would be able to say that it had imposed whatever requirements it wanted on the entire subdivision. And in fact, the fact that we're delaying this, the town may even be able to impose more stringent standards in the future to the property than are existing today. And then the final point is about the pressure to develop the property. And we feel like if we separate this into its major components, we will be reducing the potential for pressure on future owners to go out and proactively carve up the property some more to make sure that they're going to be able to afford the new restrictions that could be imposed because they have just no control over what somebody in a far distant part of the property is going to do. So I think there are good and sufficient reasons for the board to accept the language that we've put as part of our plan, and we've had discussions with your corporate town council, and he seemed to indicate that it was within the planning board's authority to accept our language for the condition of approval, and we would hope that you would.
As I understood your plan originally, you weren't going to sell the lot to the individual members?
No.
No. So they're just going to be allowed by the corporations to build on that particular lot?
They're going to be leasing. This discussion is
hypothetical.
Is all hypothetical, making sure that we were asked to think about how a review would happen on a public sale, because properly the planning board ought to have the chance to revisit these waivers that were granted because it is a family plan. So, you know, you have to start thinking about what conditions you might be faced with. And we've tried to provide this language in a thoughtful way that will create the most palatable situation in the future.
Nancy.
I recognize your need to address a hypothetical, but is there any reason why you feel you need to? I mean, is it likely that the family is going to fall apart?
No, we would not have addressed it had not it been made clear to us that we were receiving waivers based on our current existence, so that it needed to be clear on the plan what authority the planning board would have in the future if this happened.
Okay. My second question is to Maureen. is it possible under the ordinances to carve up a big project like this and take a part of it and rule on that part and not in another part? Is that possible?
I think I understand your question. If you're presented with a large subdivision and there's a proposal to make a change to one small area, is it possible for the board in its discretion to only review the change in that one small area? Yes, and you've done that many times.
Okay, but that isn't quite that. My question. If in 50 years everything is built out, sort of, then can you take a portion of this whole 2,000 plus area and take a look at that separately from the whole kit and caboodle?
Well, right now this application has been presented as under a single ownership.
Yeah.
If you think of this in any other part of town, at any time a developer may approach the board and have acquired one or more lots that they have assembled that have at one time or another been under separate ownership or separate lots. And I can think of, for example, the Dominicus Crossing subdivision was in fact, I believe, five individual lots that were assembled by one person and presented to the board as one application. So yes, at some point in the future, someone could take a chunk, any chunk, anywhere in this part of town and show right title and interest and propose some kind of re-subdivision, and the board could look at that. But the point is that you're granting subdivision approval over the whole thing, so if there's any change made in any of these areas that alter that subdivision, it does have to come back to the planning board.
And what would we then rule on? The whole application? This application?
That's what this list, that's what this note, this discussion is about.
Yeah.
Because of the special status that the applicant has proposed for this project, because it is a family subdivision, I believe that's been the board's basis for treating many of these issues. And consequently, this is a special circumstance that we've had to deal with other subdivisions. The board has not treated this type of special circumstance.
Mm-hmm.
There are not other subdivisions in town that I'm aware of where the board has waived all of the standards that have been waived for this subdivision. Consequently, this issue doesn't come up. If an amendment is going to be proposed, we never worry about what the extent of the planning board's review is because we expect it to be the complete review. In this case, it's possible that a proposed amendment could have dramatically, I guess that's the question for the board to think about. Can you imagine a proposal to amend what is currently before you in such a way that you would want to revisit all the waivers that you've granted.
Would we necessarily have to do that?
No.
No.
Do you want to preserve the option to do that?
Yes. Obviously, as Mr. Sprague pointed out, if the corporation sold the bulk of its land holdings in the Cape to a developer or something of that sort, then that would certainly trigger a that it would have to come back and go through the whole process again. As to an individual lot, I don't feel the same way. I would be content with a more localized review, but I'm not exactly sure what limits we should have on that. I haven't really thought through on that issue. But you know, it's possible to envision a situation where the corporation would sell, or had to sell, or went out of business, or lost its charter. Or, theoretically, anything is possible, I suppose.
But you're not expecting it.
No,
in your lifetime.
Very hard to stay in business.
I admire you for bringing this to our attention, because this is a very far-sighted. Far-sighted to the point of me trying to envision how such a consequence, given that it acknowledges special treatment in the past, then even comes to the planning board. Subdivision of land comes to us, but just a lot that already exists on the face of the earth changing hands doesn't, I don't believe that's something that automatically then jumps into the planning board's lap.
It would be almost like a deed restriction.
Has the town, has anyone given consideration to needing to track
but the point is,
any real estate
Maureen
activity
pointed out,
the town.
They received a lot of waivers. There's no low-income areas. They received a lot of help on roads and things of this sort that the normal subdivision doesn't get. Not they would turn around and sell the lots, which I'm sure they're not going to do.
But obviously, a real estate transfer at some point in time, 15 years down the road, if after the fact came to the planning board and received conditions, that would be an extremely, that would not really.